Hello, my name is Katie and I work as the Learning and Outreach Officer for Pathways. Pathways is the partnership of universities and further education colleges working with learners across Leicester, Leicestershire and Rutland. We support young people with information, advice and guidance so they can make an informed decision on different education routes and the one that's right for them. This video is going to introduce some of the routes into higher education. We'll cover different qualification levels, introduce the basics of student finance, hear from some current students, and look at some of the support that's available to you. Before we get started on our exploration, I'm going to quickly define some words and phrases you might hear throughout this video. First up is further education. This refers to any education choices you make after your 16th birthday or after year 11. Sometimes talked about as your post-16 options, or FE. It might include studying A-levels, level 3 BTECs, T-levels, or by going to a sixth form in your local area. Everyone needs to stay in some form of education until they are at least 18 years old. Higher education, sometimes referred to as HE, applies to any courses that are taken after your 18th birthday. It's often mistaken as just being courses or qualifications taken at university, but actually includes any form of education at level 4 and above. Different types of qualifications have different levels attached to them, which we'll explore in a little bit of detail now. So qualification levels go from level 1 to level 8. If you are doing your post-16 options, then you are at level 3. So if you're studying a course like A-levels, any BTEC National Diplomas, T-levels, or NVQs. Level 4 is the next step on. This is sometimes referred to as the first year of your university degree. It could be a Higher National Certificate, or HNC. It could also be the first year of a foundation degree. And some other vocational qualifications and degree apprenticeships also top out at level 4. Level 5 could be your second year of a university degree or the second year of your foundation degree. It could be a Higher National Diploma, an HND, and again, some apprenticeships and other vocational qualifications top out at level 5. Level 6 is often your final year of your university degree, as well as some professional qualifications, other degree apprenticeships and higher apprenticeships too. Level 7 and level 8 are sometimes known as postgraduate qualifications. Level 7 can include master's degrees, or if you want to study to become a teacher and you do your postgraduate certificate of education, PGCE. Level 8 is often referred to as a PhD or doctorate qualification. Entry routes into higher education are really varied. While an established route onto a university degree, and one you may have heard most about, is by taking 3 A-levels, you can access HE through vocational routes, such as a level 3 BTEC extended diploma and T-levels. And while a lot of students go on to study higher education straight from sixth form or college, many people take a gap year or more before returning to study. Please remember that the doors to higher education doesn't close at 18. Some of the local higher education options available at colleges, such as Leicester College, Brooksby Melton College, Loughborough College, Stevenson College, or North Warwickshire South Leicestershire College, include those level 4, 5 qualifications, such as the Higher National Certificates, Higher National Diplomas, Apprenticeships, and Foundation Degrees. The higher education options at the University of Leicester, De Montfort University, Loughborough University may also include foundation years, sometimes known as Year Zero, may include undergraduate degrees, degree apprenticeships, and postgraduate courses. There are loads of different courses that you can study at higher education across the UK. This slide shows some of the more unusual ones, but there really is any depth and breadth of subject that you'd like to study. And you can study really anywhere in the country. You can stay local, or you can travel all the way up to the top end of Scotland or the bottom end of Cornwall. There really is a huge variety of options available to you. I'd like you to pause the video now and visit Kahoot.it and enter in the PIN 0571 6222. This is just a short quiz that will test some of your knowledge and some of the things that we've just mentioned previously. Once you finish the quiz, come back to this video and press play. We're now going to talk about finance and support in higher education. I'm going to start off with a short video from Student Finance England and then go into a little bit more depth about some of the support on offer in the form of tuition fee loans and maintenance loans, including how to repay them.
Students at uni or college have two main costs: tuition fees and living costs. The good news is that there's lots of financial help available to help pay for these. There's a tuition fee loan to cover fees and a loan to help pay for living costs, such as rent, books, or travel. As with any other loan, these have to be repaid. The difference here is that student loans don't have to be paid back until the student has finished or left their course and their income is over a certain amount of money. The amount repaid each month will be based on their income, not how much they borrowed. Interest will be charged from the day the first student finance payment is made to the student until the loan is repaid in full or cancelled. There's also extra financial help available for students with a disability or students who have children or an adult who depends on them financially. Unlike loans, these don't usually have to be paid back.
Student Finance England are the company that provides financial support on behalf of the UK government to students from England entering higher education in the UK. They've got a really useful YouTube channel, and I really recommend checking out some of those videos to get more information about the support that's on offer to students across England. So we'll look in a bit more detail at the support that is available to help pay for university, and start off with, we'll look at the tuition fee loan. This is paid by Student Finance England directly to the university or college on your behalf and covers course fees up to £9,250 per year. This means you won't have to pay any tuition fees up front, but you will have to pay it back, but only when you're earning above the repayment threshold. The maintenance loan is money paid to you to help towards your living costs, basically your student income. This is paid directly into your bank account at the start of each term, and the amount varies depending on a number of things, including whether or not you will be living and studying in London. You get slightly more if studying in London due to the cost of living down there. And like the tuition fee loan, you will have to repay it once you finish your course and are earning a certain amount. This slide gives you a bit of an idea how much you might receive depending on whether you're living in London or not, and their estimates for the 2021-2022 year. For a more exact calculation on what you might be eligible for, then the gov.uk website on screen is there, and you can use the student finance calculator that's available. Next, we'll talk about repaying your student loan. The key things to remember about paying your student loan are that you won't make repayments until you finish at university and your earnings are over a certain amount, which we call the repayment threshold. At the moment, the repayment threshold is just over £27,000 per year. The amount you repay is 9% of everything over the threshold amount. For example, if you're earning £28,000 per year before tax, you'll be making monthly repayments of £5. If your income changes, your repayments change too, but this is all done automatically. If at any point your income drops below the threshold, your repayments stop. And after 30 years, any outstanding loan balance is wiped off, whether you've paid nearly all of it, only some of it, or none of it at all. Don't forget also that interest is charged on your student loans from the day the first payment is made until the loan is repaid in full or cancelled. The interest rate is linked to inflation and will vary depending on your circumstances. More information on interest and repayments is available by following the link on screen, which is gov.uk/repaying your student loan. Okay, but why do people go on to higher education? There are lots of reasons that people choose to study higher education courses, and they'll be quite personal from individual to individual. Many people study at higher education to access better employment prospects. For some jobs, having an HE qualification is necessary to gain employment. For example, all new police officers in England and Wales will have to be educated at degree level now. But even if you don't have a specific job or career in mind, you might find lots of benefits to staying in education. This includes learning more about subjects you really enjoy, developing new skills or attributes, getting an opportunity to meet new people from around the country or the world, and a chance to take up new hobbies or sports. You may choose to move to a different part of the country and develop your independence, but even enrolling at a local provider will develop some of those life skills like time management, taking responsibility for your own goals, and budgeting your money. As I've said, choosing to go on to higher education is a personal choice, and we've looked at some of the reasons why people choose to continue, but it's also important to look at reasons not to choose. Don't feel pressured to choose the same route as friends who are choosing particular places or courses to study. Try and take some time to reflect on your own strengths, interests, and ideas. You'll make new friends whatever course or route you pick, and for some people, choosing a different course or place to study away from their friends from home has helped them become the person they always wanted to be. Secondly, don't choose a course because you think it's going to be an easy option. The jump from post-16 courses to higher education courses is a big one, and it takes time to adjust to the new way of learning and being taught. Thirdly, don't choose an option because it's the only one you know about. Make sure you take some time to do research on the range of options open to you and make a list of the pros and cons that come to mind. A lot of higher education courses can open up routes to jobs and careers in a broad range of areas. For example, you don't need to do a management degree to work in business. It can help, but the transferable skills you develop on a course like English can be just as relevant to a career in business. And finally, don't choose a course or option because someone has told you to. I appreciate this can be difficult, and sometimes parents or teachers might try and pressure you to go down a particular route. But if you've taken some time to reflect on your own interests and strengths and have done some research on lots of different routes, hopefully you'll feel more confident to explain why you want to study a particular subject or go down a particular route to those around you. We're now going to watch a video of three different students who are studying different courses at different HE providers. I'd like you to listen to some of their thoughts and insights into life on their higher education courses, see if any resonate with you.
Hi, my name is Sophie. I'm in my first year at Loughborough College and I'm studying sports science with management.
Hi, my name is Fahima. I'm in my final year doing a degree in English at the University of Leicester.
Yeah, well, my name's Eddie and I'm doing product design and technology in my first year at Loughborough University.
Okay, so with my sports science with management degree, I picked this one because I noticed through all of my like A-levels and my GCSEs, I really enjoyed like working in teams and like leading in teams. And I thought maybe the management side of things was something that I wanted to go and do. So I love management and I love sports. Looking at all the sports science courses around at university, all of them are similar, but some of them do have like different things. So I chose the sports science with management in particular. Sports science is all pretty much in the first year kind of the same. So you learn about the human body, you learn about the history of sport, you learn how to coach people. And what I really love about studying it at university is in the next few years, I'll get to choose depending on what I like, what I want to go down. So if I end up really liking all the stuff about the human body and want to do more about that, I can choose different sections so that I'm learning about that and I can go really in depth with it. I think that as well, if you're choosing something that you really love at university, like I have, you're never going to find any of it boring and you're never going to think of it as studying, which is what I was a bit worried about when I was leaving my A-levels. I kind of found everything a bit boring because I kind of had to do it. But now that I've picked what I want to do, I love all of it and it doesn't feel like you're studying and it never feels like a drag. So that's what I love.
Yep. So I decided to do an English degree because of the variety of job options it can give me and also because I enjoy English. So in my degree, it's quite varied. You get to choose what you want to do, which is what I like about it. So, for example, with an English degree, you could go into things like publishing, journalism. And if you're interested in that, you can choose to study certain modules. So those are kind of like subjects within the degree to do with publishing, etc. So for me, I prefer literature over language. So it was all about choosing things about literature, like the Victorian era and the literature within the era. And what I really like about the degree is it touches upon history as well. So I get to learn about ancient Greece. I get to learn about the Victorian period, the Renaissance period. It's also enjoyable and it's what I love to do. And for me, it's all about what I wanted to do in the future. So at first I wasn't too sure about my career, because with English, it's such a varied subject, you'd think, where could it take me? And all I heard around me was those who did English wanted to go into teaching, and I didn't want to go into teaching. For me, I wanted to do something different.
Okay. I think one of my favourite things about doing product design technology at university is how many different areas it covers, because I'm not completely sure which area of design I want to get a job in yet. But we cover like a really big, broad range of things. So there's the technological ones like electronics and materials, but then there's also, you get to do things like woodworking, sketching, CAD. And I remember when I was coming in, I was quite worried because my sketching skills weren't all that good. But with things like sketching, foam modelling, that kind of thing, they really make sure that everyone has quite a strong foundation in all of the really basic skills. For example, with sketching and stuff like creating and two-point perspective and that kind of thing. So, you know, whether you're really good at it or you're not so good at it, everyone kind of gets to the same level and gets to know the same kind of skills. So that's, yeah, one of the things I really like about the course, how varied it is.
Okay. So how do you apply to higher education courses? Well, UCAS is the website where you can search and submit an application for up to 5 higher education courses at university or college. There are some exceptions to how many courses you can apply for. For example, you can only apply to up to 4 medicine degrees, and you can only apply to either Oxford or Cambridge. Most application deadlines are the 15th of January, but for courses like medicine, dentistry, veterinary science, or any courses at Oxford or Cambridge, the deadline is 15th of October. The best thing to do really is to check out UCAS.com. There's loads of frequently asked questions on the site and some really good jumping off points for your research. I'm going to touch briefly on support for students with disabilities and also support for students with care experience. Now, if these two sections don't apply to you, then feel free to skip forward. But I wanted to include these because there's going to be a lot of different people watching this video. And I wanted to make sure that if any of those categories fit you as a viewer, then they are there for you to know that there is support out there. So disability support at higher education providers is really varied, and you may have to do some independent research to find out what is on offer at a particular provider that you're interested in studying at. But generally, some of the things that you see on screen should be available, especially the Disabled Students Allowance, or the DSA. This helps pay for the extra costs associated with studying that are incurred as a direct result of a disability or specific learning difficulty or long-term condition. The allowance can help to pay for a non-medical personal helper. It can help pay for items of specialist equipment, assistive software, travel, and other course-related costs like additional printing. The allowance is not means-tested nor repayable, so the money you get doesn't depend on where you're studying, what your household income is, and you don't have to repay it. DSAs are provided by Student Finance England, and there is a separate application process. And the maximum amount that you can claim per year is £25,000, although most students will get significantly less than this. Other areas where the student support team might be able to help include things like exam arrangements, so arranging for additional time or quieter exam spaces. They might be able to help with equipment loans or negotiating support in other areas of the university or college, including within the library and your course tutors. You may also be able to access dyslexia assessments, as well as quieter study spaces and study skills support. Our top tip is to please share your disability or long-term condition on your UCAS application form. It helps the colleges or universities you're applying to make sure that they're giving you the right support to get the most out of your learning. The information that you share is kept confidential and will not impact your chances of being offered a place on a course. Next, we're going to look at support for care leavers or estranged students. And again, each university or college will have different supports available. You can't guarantee that just because one place offers something that another one will offer the same. So make sure that you do some research ahead of your application. In general, though, universities and colleges tend to provide support in the way of a designated advisor that specifically works with care leavers or students who are estranged from their families. They're likely to have an understanding of your circumstances and can advise on what support you can access. Some HE providers will provide help with accommodation, especially during vacations. This does vary quite a bit, so do make sure that you do your research. And they may also offer financial advice and support in the way of bursaries, which are pots of free money to students to help with their living costs. You might have the opportunity to access specific careers advice for care leavers and advice and guidance before you even apply to your course of choice, and ongoing guidance to help with your transition onto higher education. Have a good look at propel.org.uk, where you can clearly see the support available at universities and colleges. There's also a really good charity called becomecharity.org.uk, which has fact sheets for care leavers or students who are estranged from their families to find out more about money management, your rights, and a chance to help you reach higher. Okay, I've put higher apprenticeships and degree apprenticeships at this point in the presentation, because these are another way of gaining a higher education qualification. They don't have a neat application cycle like UCAS. So to start an apprenticeship, you must be 16 or over and not in full-time education. Apprentices will study for qualifications while working, and they learn the skills they need for the job that they're doing. There are different levels of apprenticeship, from intermediate, which is equivalent to 5 GCSEs, or level 2. There's advanced apprenticeships, which are level 3 qualifications, higher apprenticeships, which fall between level 4 and 5, and full degree apprenticeships, which land between sort of level 6 and 7. Higher apprenticeships are most common in areas like business administration and law, construction planning in the built environment, and information and communication technology, but they are available in other areas too. There aren't as many higher apprenticeships available overall as intermediate and advanced ones, so you may have to keep looking to find the opportunity you want. Degree apprenticeships do also exist, but again, they can be quite hard to find. Currently, you can get degree apprenticeships in areas like aerospace engineering or automotive engineering, banking relationship management, defense systems engineering, digital, power systems, or public relations. With a degree apprenticeship, your tuition fees are covered. And as you're going to be earning money because you're working full-time but studying part-time at university, you are unlikely to qualify for a maintenance loan. So some students choose an apprenticeship because they see it as a direct route to employment, or they prefer a physical approach to learning and gaining skills. They're interested in a particular industry or career and they know that right now. And they're interested in working full-time after their GCSEs or their post-16 options. But the thing to remember is that these are advertised roles rather than specific courses. So colleges like Loughborough College and Leicester College have a search function for advanced and intermediate apprenticeships. There may also be higher in degree apprenticeships advertised, but not as regularly. You'll also need to register with the government's Find an Apprenticeship service in order to apply. Please think of apprenticeships as jobs with education rather than education with work experience. There's no set cycle of applying to apprenticeships. Vacancies come up as and when they are available, so you will need to keep looking and refreshing to find the opportunity that you want. Okay, we've got another Kahoot quiz, which is open until the 10th of May. So if you are watching this video before the 10th of May, please do pause the video now, open up kahoot.it, and enter the PIN 0689-0682. That should take you to 8 questions that will cover some of the things that we've talked about just now. Okay, so what do you do next? Well, luckily there's lots of support available when it comes to thinking about your next steps. Your school or college is usually the best place to start, but there's also a wealth of information online. We've already mentioned UCAS.com as a place to submit your application, but as I also mentioned, it's a great place to start that research jumping off point and find out lots of different routes and information available out there. Prospects.ac.uk is a really good site for finding out a little bit more about particular jobs or careers that could be opened up to you if you continue studying at higher education. And sometimes you can use that to work backwards and see what sort of education route you may need to take if there's a particular job or career area that you're interested in. Other sites include Amazing Apprenticeships and the National Career Service too. You can also visit universities or colleges from the comfort of your own home. At our website, pathways2he.ac.uk, you can explore lots of resources that will help you with your research. You can also take some virtual tours around University of Leicester, Loughborough University and De Montfort University. You can take a sneak peek into a number of buildings, watch videos highlighting parts of the campus and the facilities available, and explore the individual partners' universities to find out more about the courses on offer. So we're nearly at the end of our video. I just wanted to remind you that we've been Pathways with that partnership of universities and colleges across Leicester, Leicestershire and Rutland. And we're available on lots of different social media channels, including Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. Just search for Pathways EM on most of those platforms and you'll find us. Thank you very much for watching, and we hope you found it helpful.